is Super JJ. This is the lower match.
Yep.
For this group, the group that Dan actually came out on top 2-0.
Yeah.
What'd you think of that?
I mean, nobody expected it. I heard the conversations downstairs, right? They already thought in this first round that he had some chance, but, you know, it was risky. And then going in against Oskaka, nobody expected him to win.
I mean...
Like, absolutely no one.
Froden was probably one of the guy, if not one of the guys, if not the guy, who prepared the most for this event.
Yep.
Yeah.
I mean, from what I've heard, practicing 18 hours a day. I don't even know if it's possible. But
I haven't heard that, but...
I guess if anyone can do it, it's Froden, right? Everything he does it with passion. And so did he prepare for his event and went 6-0. I mean, deservedly so, right?
Yeah.
He's a grinder. Froden's definitely a grinder. So I'm actually, I'm not surprised as well. I know a lot of people were saying, we talked about it in the cast, but there was like, when the C-Story Cup group was announced, there was a Reddit thread, and people were like, oh, group of death, rip Froden.
So first of all, you guys think Froden will be able to replicate or even surpass his previous Seed Story accomplishment?
Froden's going to win the whole thing.
You think,
it now.
You think so? Oh. Yeah. What do you think?
I think his plays are really good, but he definitely gets more nervous than when he's casting, that's for sure. That's the most stressed I've ever seen him is when he's in that booth playing. So yeah, as long as he hangs on to the nerves, right, I think he's doing really well. But
I'm predicting quarterfinals again.
Quarterfinals?
Yeah.
Cool.
Yeah. Casting's not nerve-wracking. Because when you're
some people would definitely disagree with that.
You can get top decked in a match. You can't get top decked when you're
JJ
casting.
JJ looking focused. Definitely wants this win.
All right. Well, we're a little bit late on the spectating, so our bad. We're jumping into the game right now, or should be in a second. Both these guys have pretty much at least similar lineups on paper. The Druid Shaman Warlock Warrior are their decks, and they both ban Warrior away from each other. So it seems to be a common trend over the course of the...
I know the Druids are different anyways. JJ was playing C'Thun Druid, and Starko was playing the Token Druid.
Yeah, this is far from a mirror match for sure, and we're starting things off right away with Strifecrow playing Aggro Shaman versus JJ playing his C'Thun Druid.
Generally, I'd say Shaman's a little favored, but it's a pretty close match, right?
Yeah, it depends. The mid-range Shaman has a much better matchup, I think. Just because they curve out a little bit heavier, so they have a better way to deal with like the bigger stuff. But also at the same time, Aggro Shamans can just win the game against any deck if they get a powerful enough start.
Yeah, Strifecrow is one of those key cards as well in this matchup. The Flame Wreath Baseless Druids that generally have a lot of problems dealing with a 4-mana 7-7.
I think you can insert that exact sentence into every single matchup with a different class.
Warrior can execute it.
Yeah, Warrior can execute, for example.
They all right,
besides
answer.
Warrior, but Warrior's always banned.
Rogue can sap it.
Mm-hmm. There's a bunch of solutions, but Druid is sorely lacking them, except for maybe the occasional mulch. Which I don't think that Super JJ actually runs that in.
Are we going to comment that there's a Mark of the Wild? That's an almost never seen played card.
Oh, what? Was that? What? That was not the Raven Idol? What?
No, that's common.
That's his actual card in his deck is Mark of the Wild.
Yeah, but not off of Raven Idol, so that's a surprising factor right there. Yeah, for sure. I mean, Mark of the Wild.
It's like an anti-aggro card, I guess, right? He's giving the taunt to something and try to stop anybody's
damage. I've seen some C'Thun Druid lists tinkering with Sunfear Protector or Defender of Argus, for example, to enable Kluxi Ember Weavers to have an insanely good matchup against other aggressive decks. Once you put a Mark of the Wild on the Kluxi Ember Weaver, it pretty much feels the same thing, right?
Yeah,
giving you a huge taunt.
That makes a lot of sense. I mean, most of the cards in the Druid deck already have some taunt accompanying them, right? So then the Kluxi Emberweaver is a great choice for that. Is 4/10 is absolutely massive already.
Yeah, I think a lot of... there was for a while a lot of C'Thun Druids not playing Kluxi Emberweaver or only playing one of them. Because one, it was a little bit inconsistent. You didn't always get it right on four, the buff. And two, it could be ignored a lot of the time. Like you can't ignore Dark Arakoa because, you know, it's got more power, it's got taunt. And Kluxi Emberweaver at that four power got to the point where it was a little bit ignorable in some matchups, especially the more aggressive matchups. And so I think, that would be a smart choice. We'll see if that's going to become popular, more taunt-heavy stuff in...
There's a lot of choice Druid. Coming out for the Druid this turn. You can clear the whole board if you Mark the Wild, trade Wrath, and then trade again with the 1-1. You can also develop the Beckoner and just leave the Totem Golem in play, which presumably hits the... taunted tree, so then you're going to do good damage to it and clean it up with a hero power next turn. This goes for the full clear.
Yeah. I think being proactive definitely has merit here, as opposed to like hoping your opponent doesn't have a way to punish you for playing Beckoner of Evil.
Yeah, exactly. I mean, as long as you keep the Shaman board clear at all times, a lot of cards, like Abusive Sergeant and Flame Tongue Totem, they just get counteracted completely.
Yeah.
Zero power is really unfortunate for Shaman at the moment, since he needs board control, and the stage shot doesn't help at all for multiple turns.
It's not going to be unfortunate later, though. Be quite fortunate. Two damage to face is the most fortunate thing I could think of at the moment.
So you have a big issue of running out of cards here. You could drop everything and then, you know, you set up a nice board control, but you're only going to have your six, and then you have to top deck the rest of the game, which is really scary as C'Thun Druid.
Druid is pretty good at top decking, though, in general, right? I mean, yeah. A lot of big minions, a bunch of card draw as well. If JJ draws a Nourish, that would be huge.
Why do you think so many players are switching over from C'Thun Druid to the token Yogg Druid? Like, why is token Yogg Druid all of a sudden considered better? Like, what happened?
Well, personally, I think Yogg-Saron's the best card in the game, right?
All right, besides the Yogg-Saron, if you look at the... Because a deck that can't win without Yogg-Saron is not a good deck. So if we take out Yogg-Saron and look at the 29 cards that make up the rest of the deck, why did this deck all of a sudden become popular over C'Thun Druid?
See, when you consider that Shaman and Zoo are some of the most popular decks in the current meta game, fighting for the board early on is what Yogg Druid can do way better, thanks to Violet Teacher in most part.
Okay.
So that's the main reason.
Yeah, I guess the C'Thun Druid just has to go for the late game, right? And like Druid's advantage is normally getting something out early, so.
Yeah. It's a good succinct couple of answers.
Well, I think you play 4-mana 7/7 this turn. Yeah. Seems pretty good.
And we're not talking about Eerie Statue.
Ooh. That's nice. Can't play it yet, but definitely going to be a big impact card for later, which he needs.
Yeah, I mean, there's... is there merit to just not playing the Dark Arrow Claw?
No.
it dies for free.
Yeah, yeah, but then you have the 2/2 left over to kill, right?
And you can just easily draw Living Roots or Wrath or another Disciple of C'Thun.
But you only get one. And you're probably... Yeah, I guess so. If you're playing Rag next turn... Maybe there's merit to not.
If you had anything else you could play, right? If you had like an Azurdrake, I think you'd play the Azurdrake.
Yeah.
But with passing the turn would just be really bad.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's a tough pill to swallow, but I think JJ has to go for it here.
Yeah. There actually is a good chance that Beckoner of Evil will just kill it next turn. Because it'll be alive with 2 health.
You could even consider trading the Beckoner into it this turn. Leaving the 1-1 up's not that bad, and you have an empty turn next turn, so hero power anyways. Because otherwise he has the chance to remove it with a spell and prevent the trade later.
Yeah.
Well, I mean, yeah, you can Lava Burst the 2-2, right? That feels really terrible, but...
It's either that or Argent Squire hero power. So it's either... Deal 2 damage, develop a 1/1, and effectively kill off your 7/7.
Yeah,
or overload yourself and...
What's going on through Strivecrow's head probably right now is how likely is it that JJ, in those 2 cards that he's going to have, will have a 2-damage source against that 7/7? Yeah.
Because you really want to get that Doomhammer online as fast as possible, right?
Yeah.
And that Lava Burst delays it.
Yeah, actually, I think I like the hero power play. I mean, you're starting up the face damage, right? And the next turn, Doomhammer face damage, you still have Lava Burst. Plus, with your opponent only having 1 card, you're probably assuming they don't have something useful or at least powerful.
Also, Lava Burst might be necessary to help you take out a minion to push more damage to later on, but Trevor's going to go ahead and go with the Lava Burst.
He's not afraid.
This is going to delay the Doomhammer, and he's not going to have that powerful play going in the next turn.
That was a really good creature draw.
But seven attack going in is arguably better than getting in for 4 with Doomhammer.
I suppose. But what about getting in for 4 the next turn?
So Taunt Totem would be huge. Oh, no, but he has Stage Shot, of course.
Taunt Totem would be huge.
Yeah, never
lucky. It'd be game-breaking.
Well, Well, this Divine Shield's really frustrating. Even once it trades with the 7-2, like, you still have a 4-2 on the board, you can't kill that efficiently.
Yeah. Doomhammer will effectively answer. There's the Classy Amberweaver there. But
would you play it? I mean, Ragnaros hitting the 1-1s are not ideal, but at least you develop the Ragnaros for later then.
Yeah, I think you just float too much.
Playing the Ragnaros is perfectly fine here. I mean, he's just going for the 50-50 to the face. If it hits, then it's huge.
Unlucky. Maximum damage.
it's still a rag that's going to be on the board. It's not like Strifecrow's going to kill it.
That was a nice draw for Strifecrow. You can play the Tuskar Totemic and then the Thing from Below to put a lot of things on the board. All right. So you could have had a lot of creatures there, and when you had the Taunt in play, the Druid can't Hero Power the 1-1, which would mean the Ragnaros is going to be hitting a lot less likely. But the Doomhammer starts up damage earlier, so.
Yeah. I mean that's what Strifecrow has to have his eyes set on at the moment, is just JJ's health total. It says 14. Well, I got to try and start pushing that damage. I'm dealing 6 every turn. All of a sudden, if he draws and do Rock Biter Weapon or second Lava Burst, he shortens that clock down to just 2 turns from now, so.
Yeah, it's too bad, though, that Strifecrow won't be able to play both the Tuskar Totemic and the Thing from Below next turn, thanks to the overload from the Doomhammer.
That was actually a pretty game-defining turn, what he chose to do that last turn. Even with only a couple cards in your hand as a Shaman, they're just such staggeringly different plays for what your options provide.
Yeah. Strifecrow is a player who takes his time a lot. And that was one of the faster plays that he's made. It's kind of funny, this game, he's taken his time on turns that were pretty arbitrary, and he's snap-called turns that seemed like there was more to think about.
Well, this looks pretty grim.
Yeah, it looks like he's dead. Not quite, but...
Not necessarily.
It looks like it.
There's potential lethal for sure. For Super JJ.
I mean, I suppose if he lives, he can actually draw Rockbiter and win next turn.
See what he gets. Searing Totem doesn't help him at all.
It's probably the worst totem.
Well, so with the current board state, Super JJ will have the chance to go for 50-50 lethal by killing off 2 minions. Oh, unless Strifecrow decides to trade. Does this change anything?
No.
Yeah, well, now it's still the 50-50. No, it's not the 50-50 because, he needs to go face with the...
Now it's a 50-50.
With the draw, the 7 of Cthulhu.
Oh, yeah. So, but this could be a big deal because if he loses this... I mean, he doesn't even have a choice, but if he loses this, there is a possibility that Strifecrow can win.
Of course, 1 rock bite away from winning.
Yeah. Actually, no.
Even a Lava Burst would do it, right?
Yeah.
Still have the 2-1 on board.
Yeah, that's right. Yeah, that's right. The 2-1 would be on board. I was thinking if the 2-1 didn't go on board, but he'd also have to Hero Power into the Searing Totem, so that would mean he'd go down to 12. So yeah, just Rockbiter. But it's going to be close.
Oh, Ragnaros, my old friend. How are you going to decide this game? Statistically, JJ should hit this since he missed the one important one before, right? So...
Yeah.
Obviously, that means the odds are in his favor.
A sample size of 2 determines statistics.
Are you telling me the Tarstone is a fair game?
All right, here
we go. We'll see Ragnaros, and he wins in the game. Yeah. So JJ takes the first game over Strifecrow, eliminating his Shaman. And yeah, we'll have to see what Strifecrow chooses next.
Yeah, JJ looks actually kind of upset right now. I mean, I guess that is his first win of the tournament, but and it wasn't clean, I guess, by any means.
Yeah, that was close.
Having to rely on Ragnaros for the last shot, but you know, you got to feel a little bit good after that one.
Well, JJ is looking forward to the future, and he's not happy about not facing Froden and facing Oskaka for a second time instead.
Yeah.
He's a little bit worried about that matchup.
Well, I mean, judging by Super JJ's performance of the last Seed Story Cup, I would hope that he would come into this one with really high expectations. I mean, a lot of people were considering him the favorite coming in, and for good reason. Because, like I said, his performance is the last one, and also just JJ's performance recently. He had his, like, American tour where he went to the North America for, I don't know, 3 weeks.
Oh, yeah, I saw him when he was
competed
there.
Competed at EGLX, competed at the PAX Open at Boston, competed at DreamHack Austin.
Yep.
So,
although, so last year he went with Reno Freeze Mage, I'm pretty sure, right?
Reno Freeze Mage.
Cool deck.
The tournament debut of Reno Jackson right there.
Yeah, it was kind of funny going back and watching that cast. And first of all, I was confused because Reno didn't have the glow yet.
Oh, yeah.
And so players actually had to keep track on their notes. Like, especially with Reno Freeze Mage, you actually have two ups. Watching like JJ meticulously take notes. And also, what was it? I can't remember. People were so confused about a specific interaction between the new Leave Explorer cards. I'm trying to think about what it was.
Forgotten Torch, maybe.
Oh, it was Forgotten Torch. Yeah, they were struggling to distinguish which one was Forgotten Torch and which one was Roaring Torch.
So, I've actually heard people say that they think C'Thun Druid is favored in this as long as they draw C'Thun. Because generally, if you get to 10, which you should always do as a Druid, and you play C'Thun, you win. But if you don't draw C'Thun, probably the Zoo wins.
Yeah, that's a big if you get to 10. I mean, Zoo definitely, with an explosive start, like we see here with the Flame Imp as an opening, can go very fast. But JJ, of course, has the perfect answers here with Living Roots and Swipe to any kind of board that Strifecore can have in the early game.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So this is, nice play. I was just going to say, this is a big consideration, right? If he has Living Roots, then your Flame Imp dies, but now you've developed a creature that can't die this turn.
And this encourages either your opponent to play off curve by not playing Living Roots this turn, or playing 1/1s, which is going to get eaten up, which is just, you know, pretty bad. They're probably not going to do that, so this really forces sort of an off-curve solution from Super JJ.
That 4-drop looks pretty appealing. It's like a shielded mini-bot with +2 attack. Quite a nice early game creature.
Yeah, innervating something like that out is not really appealing, though.
Really? You don't like it here? I mean, it kills the Voidwalker, and then it'll still be a 4-2 to trade with what's next.
Yeah, but what if what's next is like an Abusive Sergeant? It's like you traded an innervate and a 4-drop or 2 1-drops. I don't know.
Ooh.
Is that Bran?
That's cute.
Okay. I mean, no battle cries really in the hand right now. C'Thun's chosen battle cry is inconsequential unless he draws Twin Imps or Klaxi Amberweaver early.
Yeah, well, Disciple of C'Thun might be a good out here.
Oh yeah, that's true.
Just coin it out, get the C'Thun enabling very fast.
Warlock has a chance to kill it now, but I'm not sure how scared of that you are. He might have just played it as a creature, right? Because that was the only thing he could do to challenge.
Yeah.
Yeah, well, considering that JJ decided to innovate out this brand, and he still has the coin at his disposal, Strifecore might actually think that there is a Disciple of C'Thun in Super JJ's hand. And based on that assumption, Strifecore does go for the power walling to kill the brand, because it is a really big threat. Because imagine that JJ just plays the Disciple with the double battle cry and gets the Klaxi Emberweaver on turn 4 immediately as a 4/10.
Yeah.
Disciple's ears were burning as it floats into the hand on time.
Yeah.
Oh, wow, he's not going to play it. So I guess he just wants to do the 4-drop next turn or have the coin still for later, since coining the 3 there was pretty appealing.
Yeah, coining out a Dark Arakawa, for example, would fit the curve perfectly, right? Like Disciple into C'Thun's Chosen into coin Dark Arakawa.
Yep.
That's the game plan right there. Or even coining out the C'Thun later on.
Yeah.
Having a C'Thun one turn earlier is huge against Zoo.
Well, I guess it's pretty... doesn't matter which one he plays, right? Voidwalker and Possessed Villager are both going to trade with the Disciple.
It depends on what he's expecting. Like, Possessed Villager would be better against a bigger minion. Because... if Voidwalker has to trade up into a bigger minion, it won't leave anything behind. Or if it's Possessed Villager, will leave a 1/1 behind if it has to trade up into something bigger. I mean, if he's worried about specifically Disciple of C'Thun, then yeah.
I feel like Druid has a lot more choices than the Warlock has so far. With the Innervate, it really opened up his early curve, and each turn it looks like he has multiple plays available.
Yeah. So... Disciple of C'Thun on the 2/2, possibility. C'Thun's Chosen will trade, but again, have to use the coin, so we one turn. I mean, the deck is... C'Thun Druid seems weird, because you think of C'Thun Druid, you think it has a pretty high curve, but it actually doesn't.
No, it runs out of cards.
It runs out of cards, and it actually runs a lot of really low drops, especially if you run like Beckoner of Evil.
Yeah, which he does.
Yeah, and especially if you don't run flex cards like Raven Idol. Your curve is like you have Dark Arakoa, like your most powerful minions, maybe a Rag, which he does have, and then C'Thun. It just goes, that's like your top end.
Yeah, that's true. I mean, if for JJ to like fizzle out on his draws, he should have to pretty much draw all his early game, right?
Yeah.
And it's very unlikely that he never draws any late game. And yeah. Once he has at least one late game minion, one big Taunter, one Ragnaros, then it's usually a very stable curve.
And you can also
make the deck strong.
You can also make the point that if he draws all of his early game, then that's a good thing because then he'll buy more time to get to the late game where he could draw C'Thun.
I will note on the B stream when I was watching Zale play, he was playing C'Thun Druid as well, but he actually had Yogg-Saron in the deck. He had more of a spell-based C'Thun Druid with Raven Idols, and he had Yogg-Saron in the deck.
Have you done the math? What's the because I know you played a lot of like Yogg.
I played a lot of Yogg.
What's the ideal number of spells that you need to make Yogg?
10.
Exactly 10?
If you have 10, you're pretty much going to do something good.
Do you have a spreadsheet of math to back this up?
Yeah, actually I do.
Is it in your
In my pocket?
Suit
no,
pocket?
Unfortunately not.
Do you take it out and 10? Sell it to little kids?
10 is like the minimum to have a pretty good Yogg. 20, you always get a good Yogg. And after that, you don't even really notice. Then it just starts killing itself.
What about 27?
I've had 35 is the most I've done with a brand innervate Yogg. And yeah, it wins. It tends to win the game with that.
Well, Yogg and Load is 27, right? Because you run a King Zealot, an Emperor Thorsan, and a Yogg-Saron.
I mean, the best way is with Bran, right? Druid and you innervate it. It's the dream.
So Bran doesn't have to live in order for a double battle cry?
No.
Yeah. Druid always just does everything better than everybody else.
All right, so, yeah, you have options this turn. The innervate opens things up. I think, you know, wrathing for a card here is pretty appealing. You can clear the board without losing a Divine Shield. He's going to hear a power instead.
Yeah. I think preserving the Divine Shield, no matter what, like innervating out something, whether it be Wrath or the Hero Power, is important. But the way he does it doesn't really matter, I guess. Maybe the Wrath is sort of like an emergency card. If you can remove something with Hero Power, you might as well.
This looks really good for Druid. I mean, you have the exact 5 mana removal next turn, and you're in control of the board. Pretty dead draws for the Warlock.
But this villagers will stick around for a while. They're great at throwing themselves into Divine Shield. Direwolf Alpha's not so much.
Dude. Maybe just play the Abusive as a creature here. You've already seen Swipe, right? You just need board presence.
Yeah.
Nice positioning there, putting the Death Rattles on the outside of the board to maximize Direwolves later.
Yeah. Death Rattles, Divine Shields usually too, Argent Squires. Those belong on the outside. Anything that makes it so you can't trade inwards.
Yeah, anything that won't die that turn.
Yeah, exactly.
You need suicidal creatures in the middle.
Yeah.
We might actually see Wrath for card draw here. Just, because JJ still has no late game minions in his hand. Oh, there's a big draw for him. That's exactly what he needed. Well, not exactly what he needed. He needed that maybe this turn, actually, on 5 mana crystals.
I don't know. I think that's pretty good for the next turn. Maybe not, because he'll be on 6 mana. That's true. But being able to take out the Abusive Sergeant and develop some cheap minions here to trade in next turn, I think the Nourish is actually going to be pretty sick.
Yeah, of course.
Turn.
It will help him dig deeper into his deck for that C'Thun that he so desperately wants. Or if he draws his C'Thun immediately, it can ramp him up to it.
Yeah.
This C'Thun's Chosen is doing a lot of face damage. Never what you want to see as a Warlock, because you need to lifetap for cards, of course. Being at 14 already is a super uncomfortable position.
It's gotten him for 12, I think.
Yeah, I think so.
Yeah, Strivecrow facing down a lot of pressure, actually. He's on the defense since a couple of turns already.
Juggler's nice.
Yeah. Get an extra juggle from the Possessed Villager as well. Oh, no. Yeah. See if you can pick off the last tree.
Nice.
At least something went right.
Well, it took a while, but he finally got board control. mean, you actually might play the Disciple here, right? You Disciple the Juggler, and you can Hero Power the 1-1.
Yeah. You do that, or you Wild Growth?
Well, if you don't kill the 1-1, then it's going to kill your Disciple, right? But otherwise, the Disciple threatens the trade with the Wolf.
That's true. I guess you would have room to Wild Growth next turn as well.
Yeah, exactly. You could just Nourish into Wild Growth next turn.
Yeah. And if you pick up a 2-drop next turn. I mean, that would be much better than Wild Growth anyway, so. Yeah, that makes a lot of sense.
So what does Warlock need to recover? A Defender of Argus? You need something to kind of protect you and be safe so you can get lower on health and actually get card advantage.
Yeah. Forbidden Rituals will start. Forbidden Ritual is one of those cards that can get you back in the game pretty quickly.
Well, Life Tap into another Life Juggler.
Easy game.
Easy game, easy life.
There's no other way you can really kill the 2-1, I guess. Maybe like Peddler into something.
He doesn't even want to tap anymore. I don't know if I like that play by Thrivecrow. I mean,
really? He has the Direwolf.
Yeah, I mean, but still, like getting the extra cards, the additional options to clear, like, or getting better minions in general.
It's gonna look really funny if he plays the Amber Weaver and this whole board trades into one creature.
Yeah. Yeah, I mean, it doesn't really matter if it's 7-1-1s or 5-1-1s.
I don't know. 7-1-1s is a lot. What do you call that? What's a term when you play Forbidden Ritual for all 7-1-1s?
I think that's called Wisps of the Old Gods.
No, they're tentacles, man.
It's called a good turn. Filled up your entire board.
I need a technical term for it.
We got to invent one then.
Going full.
Full tentacles.
Going full hentai. There you go.
Too many plays. Oh, so he has that Amber Weaver taunt we were talking about the other game.
Yeah, that Amber Weaver, Mark of the Wild synergy. And also picks up a Twin Emperor Vel'Koz. Oh, it's definitely going to be a big wall of taunts for Super JJ. And he still has 25 health, so he's not under any pressure of dying. Not under any threat of dying here.
Yeah.
Oh, this is really nice. Just leave the board full. There's nothing can happen.
Yeah. Can't play that Doomguard.
So this is a merit to your play last turn, Echo. By tapping, you wouldn't have this problem, right? But the
Druid's
allowed to force a position.
Never go full tentacles.
That's a lesson that's a lesson to be learned right here, pretty much.
Super JJ will punish you.
In some sense, I guess, if you're Strifecrow, you're hoping like, I only win if he doesn't draw cards, right? So then he needs to play a creature, and I'll be able to trade. There's like some issue of you're behind, so you have to expect he won't have the good play.
Yeah. So JJ's got to be really hoping here that Strifecrow doesn't have ways to trade these up. Because even though 2/4/6 taunts is great, there are a few cards that can allow those to trade up pretty effectively. Like Direwolf Alpha plus Power Overwhelming would deal with one immediately.
So you can kill the whole board with just the tentacles. I don't know if you play the Doomguard. You could get the Councilman down this turn since that's a pretty valuable creature and Doomguard next turn.
Yeah, and if he picks up a PO here, he can deal with the 4/5. Ooh, Soulfire.
That's solid.
Yeah.
But
discarding the Doomguard, though.
Yeah, your discards are really horrible, right? Because then you could play your whole mana except the Doomguard and throw it away. Yeah, that's your best creature.
I mean, I think that's what you have to do, though, because you want to make... All right, this is not the one that I expected.
I don't mind this. You get to keep all your 1-1s.
Yeah.
I mean, all those tosses were pretty similar. The worst thing would be keep the Argent Squire, but the Councilman and Soulfire are both great cards. It's got really close.
Yeah, but Super JJ is still plenty of health with 14, and now he's going to get another big taunt.
Ooh, I'm looking along forward
with,
to this.
Yeah, killing off that Direwolf Alpha probably as well, because it's a big source of damage.
It is a 6/12 taunt.
Wow. It's Ysera with taunt, plus 2 damage.
Hmm.
Can he actually kill it?
Yeah, he can. But it costs almost his entire board.
He'll be left with two tentacles, the councilman, and the Doomguard with one health, by the looks of it.
Yeah. I guess that's actually not bad.
I think the biggest problem is you don't have any damage left. He has like one power overwhelming, one abusive sergeant. That's pretty much it. And the warlock still has a lot of cards, so.
Yeah.
It's unlikely you get anything to burst. This is that moment where you need C'Thun, right?
Yeah.
Everything's led up to this point. C'Thun's getting huge in your deck. If you drop it, easy win.
Decided to keep his healthier minions alive here instead of limiting tentacles up, not trading in the Dark Peddler. Sort of encourages the hero power into the Doom Guard. Which I suppose is pretty good. But
also a better play against Swipe.
Yeah. Yeah, going with the sort of more consistent line of play. Could have like played Azurdrake and Trangon for a game-ending Swipe, but he's already played one, and he hasn't cycled through that much of his deck. He still has like half of it left.
Considering the Druid got 12 damage in with that 4-drop, this game gotten really close at the end. Druid only has 8 health left.
So thanks to Chris Alchemist, he can actually clear the Oracle.
Yeah. Darkshire Councilman will go up to 6 with Kraze, and then 7 with Gormok. But then you...
Yeah, the 2-3 is still on the board, but yeah, might not die.
You die to second Swipe. Druid of the Claw, if it's even in the deck. We haven't seen one.
Yeah, with Mark of the Wild, I feel like it probably wouldn't be.
Yeah. It is a card that's cut quite often from C'Thun Druid. I don't want to say quite often. I've seen a lot of lists with one.
All right, multiple draws. Yeah,
there. Oh, there it is.
Woo, that's a big C'Thun.
Wow.
All right. Well, JJ is going to go up 2-0. And Strifecrow has yet to win a game in this group.
That big boy C'Thun?
Yeah. Strifecrow might be the victim of the so-called group of death. Now even more so that we saw Dan advance 6-0.
I'm really interested in this last match. It's going to be Token Druid versus C'Thun Druid. And I honestly have no idea what's favored. I mean, in general, Druid fights come out a lot to the early game. But if they have a similar start, I have no clue which one's going to be better.
You're the resident Druid expert here.
Oh, am I?
Yeah.
Yeah, well, the C'Thun Druid is slightly favored, I would say.
Yep.
Just because Druid in general has very little to deal with C'Thun, right? Mm. It's just you drop the C'Thun. First of all, you apply a lot of pressure with your early game C'Thun minions. It's hard to like come back from them as the York Druid, and then they will chip in a bunch of damage, and then C'Thun will be able to finish it off.
Right.
On the other side, almost every time they play C'Thun and you play Yogg-Saron after, Yogg-Saron comes out on top. It'll clear the C'Thun or do something to it, and you'll gain an advantage there. So if they don't kill with that, then the Yogg-Saron god tends to be a little stronger.
Yeah, that's true.
I want your Yogg-Sarons.
They're pretty good. I praise Yogg a lot.
All my Yogg-Sarons buff my opponent's C'Thun. They're like, here, take a Seal of Champions, a Blessing of Kings.
Yeah, my Yogg always puts Ancestral Spirit on enemy minions.
Well, I'd be very surprised if JJ wins this one. With that hand from Strifecrow is looking absolutely insane.
Oh, yeah.
You actually have a number of ways to approach this. You can get the Nourish for mana, or you just go with Fandral, yeah. Sounds good.
Yeah. He's still going to be a turn off from being able to play the Nourish with the Fandral bonus. So this Fandral is going to have to survive for...
I think you might play Beckoner here, even though you have no other answer, just because you know you have to kill Fandral. If you play Beckoner, at least you can draw Living Roots or Wrath to kill it. Very wild, Chris.
I guess he's just sort of conceding the fact that he has to draw... Like, Beckoner of Evil is a worse play unless he draws exactly Wrath.
Or Living Roots,
yeah.
But in the end... Strifecrow drew Wrath, so that would have been absolutely suicide.
Yeah. And JJ, not really. Ugh. I like how I feel disgust at a 4-5 now. It's like once upon a time, 4-5 was the best card in the game for Druid.
Well, now they have this Shaman 4-5 that also gives you Recombobulator +1.
Not strictly better.
And we don't even see that played.
Because sometimes it gives you a minion with less power.
Yeah.
Or less stats.
I mean, come on, Hotform. You cannot compare neutral cards like Yeti to class cards.
I guess. Clearly, Fandral's better than a Yeti too, right?
Yeah.
Oh, man. This Druid hand's just glowing. You got to love the power from Fandral where it just kind of speaks to you.
It feels powerful.
Definitely one of the most flavorful, if not the most flavorful, legendary in the new set.
This 4-5 is trouble. I think no matter what, Fandral dies, right? You need to Wrath for Innervate. But you can't. No, both Innervates are played, so.
And then what's the... I guess you just play Power of the Wild then, because Wrath is...
You actually didn't need to Nourish here. Like, obviously Nourish was a great play to get the cards, right?
Yeah.
But you could have consistently killed that with Wrath and Hero Power.
Yeah. But that's still an incredibly powerful start from Strifegro. Like, being able to, on turn 3, gain 2 mana crystals and draw 3 cards is absolutely absurd.
So he used the Power of the Wild there just to try to protect his Fandral from dying to Hero Power, but now his teachers have lost a lot of value. With 2 teachers and no Power of the Wild, his hand looks a lot worse.
Yeah. But Savage Roar might be able to make up for that. He's going to be able to Wrath for 1 and sort of protect his Violet Teacher as well by removing much of the board.
He collects the Amber Weaver, will be active. I mean, hey, a 4-10 is not bad, right?
Yeah. But it does leave that Violet Teacher up for another turn, so that's always scary. Has seen 1 Power of the Wild, like we mentioned, so maybe not as scary.
I haven't seen any Soul of the Forest from Strifegro in the matches I watched, but Soul of the Forest is always a nightmare for the Druid matches because you don't have good ways to clear the board.
Yeah. Soul of the Forest, who had Soul of the Forest? It was in the last match. Who played against?
Oh, it was Oskaka.
Oskaka, yeah. Oskaka had Soul of the Forest. I like Soul of the Forest.
Yeah, it's really good tool against control decks.
Yeah.
It pretty much gives you, as long as you have like 3 minions at least, then it almost gives you the auto win against control decks.
It needs a board, but much of the deck feels like it needs a board, and you have to just assume that you're going to be ahead on the board in the majority of your matchups.
But to be fair, you can just spawn a board out of nowhere with this deck in a lot of ways.
Yeah.
For those who don't remember all the cards, Soul of the Forest is the 4 mana card that gives every creature on your board a death rattle to summon a 2/2.
They're called minions, hot form.
Not creatures?
Not creatures. This is the wrong card game.
Oh, no. I never played Magic, so I have an excuse.
Then where did you pick up the habit of calling them creatures?
World of Warcraft.
Are they called creatures in World of Warcraft?
Yeah. Actually, they'd be called mobs, technically, but... Mob. Oh. It's my gamer lingo.
Creatures in the forest.
So yeah, that Emperor Thorison that just died gave Strifegro the opportunity to get a big board now with the second Battle Teacher. A really big board, that is.
So,
but since he already has the Violet Teacher on the board, he might not even want to play the second one.
I mean, you probably want to try for the Savage Roar, right? You just hope he doesn't have Swipe, build something really big, and that Savage Roar is going to do a one-shot next turn.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah, that's a big if.
At the very least, even with the Swipe, the turns can be awkward because you won't kill the teachers themselves.
Yeah.
Ready to learn.
They're all ready to learn. So he does have the Swipe, but...
One teacher will survive.
Yeah, so I guess you just Swipe, kill off one of the teachers, and play the Beckoner of Evil.
Seems good. You just saw him cast all his spells, so you gotta be pretty scared of what comes next.
Or you can just invest in Rag this turn. Open up an early Fire Lord Wrath IRA. Really get those 8 damage rolling.
Well, neither of the old gods have appeared yet. We're getting pretty far into the deck, so I expect someone to draw something big soon.
I mean, that's if the game lasts that long.
Yeah.
Still a chance here for Strifegro to develop another board. Depends on what he gets from this Azure Drake. And imagine if he doesn't draw any, like, good spells, just going to play Mirekeeper with the The 2-2 slime, yeah.
That 10 hours is a pretty spicy draw right there.
Wait, or can you gain a mana and then draw a card with Wild Growth?
No, it's empty mana. Oh, wait. Yeah, you're right.
Like,
yeah,
Mire Keeper to gain a mana and then Wild Growth, because you get 2/1s, which might be better than
any
draw card.
I like that play. Just plays it safe.
Yeah.
Well, or maybe he just prefers a 2-2 over 2/1s.
Yeah, but you also draw a card.
True, but you can also draw the card later. You don't have to do it now.
For 1 mana, Ecop.
Yeah, next turn.
Can you even get out of this situation? Yeah, your Living Roots, the Teacher, and Ragnaros hit the Azure Drake. So scary, though. Like, at best, there's still 5 damage on board.
Yeah.
You could do the Mark of the Wild on your 3-drop, which makes it a 5-6 with Taunt, which is not too bad. But you end up with the opponent with Spell Power, which probably punishes you.
Yeah, you give them so much room to be to react to it. Yeah, I think you have to Living Roots Rag. And I think Living Roots Rag is 100%. He's 100% dead with Swipe Savager.
Yep.
Even if it hits the Azure Drake.
Need that Yogg's, C'Thun rather, I guess. Not Yogg's, Ron on this side.
Wouldn't even have enough mana for C'Thun yet.
Yeah.
Still be dead. All right, well, it did hit the Azure Drake, but it's not going to matter.
You'd feel pretty lucky for a second there.
Yeah. For a second is the key phrase.
So, Strifecrow begins the comeback, and also... it is the first one he's won, so I'm sure that's a nice morale
boost. He's going to tilt JJ with a top deck Living Roots.
Yeah,
smart play.
Or at least attempt to tilt him. But nah, JJ probably knows there was plenty of outs.
Yeah. Yeah, there's Strifecrow's. That's the face of a man who's just won his first game of the tournament.
He's very focused. He didn't even seem to get phased from the losses, honestly.
Yeah.
Yeah, well, that's Strifecrow for you. He's just doing his thing, you know. Just playing some cards.
I've never seen Strifecrow tilted at anything.
I think Archon Team League, when he got benched. That was rough. The camera followed him to
the
bench.
I think it was more about the humiliation of the physical benching.
Yeah, that
right?
was pretty rough to watch.
There was also one moment where it was in Star Ladder, and Strifecrow was playing one of his dumb Reno...
Ouch.
All right,
he plays good decks.
One of his individualistic... Reno Mage decks.
Okay.
And he actually got Forgotten Torch from Ethereal Conjurer. And so he had 2 Roaring Torches in his deck.
Oh, yeah.
So his Reno Mage wasn't active. Yeah. Or his Reno wasn't active. But he played it anyway. And this was after the glow was implemented.
Oh.
So he played a non-glowed Reno and was surprised when it didn't heal him for 30.
That's one of those things that just doesn't come up often.
Yeah. But that's what Strifecrow's known for, is playing those weird Mage decks. You'd think that's something you'd think in your head right away. I'm a Ethereal Conjurer. I'm picking a Forgotten Torch. Stow this one away in the back of my head.
I wish you could play today, TJ.
Me?
What decks would you have brought?
Oh, I would have brought the worst decks ever. I made this, like, really weird zoo deck.
You would have brought Warrior. I know you like Warrior.
I actually played an Onog. I didn't bring Warrior. But it was actually not my fault. I actually did bring Warrior, but...
Oh, they banned it every time?
No, someone made a mistake and didn't put Warrior on my list, so I just said...
Feels bad.
Play with Mage.
Okay. Zoo against Druid. And again, the Druid has a really solid starting hand. Ho, ho, ho. No Fandral this time, but a double Innervate once again.
Any hand with double Innervate against Zoo is a good hand.
You could play Violet Teacher and Wrath this turn. Or Wild Growth, if you'd prefer. You don't even have to coin.
Yeah.
That's nuts.
But the thing is, this hand does sort of hinge on the next draw.
Yeah.
Because Violet Teacher is actually dealt with pretty easily by Zoo.
So I kind of like the Wild Growth then. And you'll get some 1/1s, and you can use the Wrath to draw for cards next turn.
Yeah, and if you pick up a Power of the Wild, then that's pretty much game over. So I just like the Wild Growth this turn. See next turn. Don't go all in too early.
On the other side, the Corruption is going to be a great answer to that Violet Teacher, since nothing else is really capable of killing it quickly.
All right. We're going for it.
Corruption, not a great card to put into your deck, but a great card to get off of Peddler.
Yeah.
Definitely underrated.
Even more effective because he chooses to use the Wrath, so there's no chance of Power Overwhelming. Having a spell that actually removes that's only option.
Well, now Strifeco doesn't have anything. He has a Wild Growth, and that's it.
Yeah, and JJ paying attention knows the coins in his hand.
But it's not about what the Druid has in hand against the zoo. It's what he has on the board. That's what it's all about.
Oh,
oh my goodness.
No, that was a nice draw.
A slight smirk just appeared on Strifecrow's face.
I mean, you know, JJ's not out of it. Next turn, we got the gang boss coming in to challenge those. The fact that the teacher got corruption was a huge deal.
Do you coin for the extra 1/1 here?
Get the Wisp?
Probably.
Because you're playing Nourish next turn no matter what.
You get to Hero Power too?
Yeah, but after playing Nourish, you will have a bunch of cards and then you would rather have the coin still in your hand.
Coin for the Living Urns?
Well, or just coin for anything.
Coin for Yogg-Saron?
Just to make your mana curve more stable.
Coin for Rag?
Rag?
Does he have Rag in this deck?
No, probably not.
Anixia? Coin for Anixia?
There was a scenarios, that's what we know.
Yeah, but we did see... Oh man, I keep blanking on the last game. Who did Dan play against in the last match?
Oskaka.
Oskaka played Anixia and scenarios.
Yeah.
Very greedy.
Wow, yeah, I didn't see that.
That's like playing Varian Wrynn and Archchief Rafam in Temple.
This is going to be pretty nice how it works out for the Warlock, I think. There's some chance that the Druid would trade in, and I might consider not playing Flame Imp, I guess, just to prevent that. Because right here, no matter what, you can play Sea Giant next turn. There's no way he attacks those into the gang boss. And a Sea Giant is just so hard for the Druid to kill.
It's basically mulch or bust a lot of times.
So that was a really smart play not to play a Flame Imp, of course. If he plays it, then trades in, and he can even squeeze the Flame Imp and Sea Giant in at the same time next turn.
Yeah. Well, there's Yogg-Saron.
A god appears. The Egyptians would be proud. No? I thought that was good.
Hey!
All right, really nice turn. The Sea Giant is going to be kind of the lifeline for the Warlock here, but he's taking so much damage. I don't know if you play the Flame Imp. It's preventing taps in the future.
Yeah, speaking of gods, remember, guys, you can tweet at Seed Story Cup. I mean, about Seed Story Cup by using the hashtags Team Anubis or Team Horus. Mm-hmm. Strafko, of course, representing that blue team Horus, and
JJ
representing Team Anubis. And yeah, I really, even though Strafko is my teammate, I really hope that Super JJ wins because I'm also repping that Team Anubis.
The winning team. You value Team Anubis over your actual team?
I'll let Cloud9 know.
Whoa.
You said that.
I mean, I get some pretty dank prizes if Team Anubis wins.
I got Jack on
speed
dial.
That's true, there's no prizes if
Cloud9
wins.
Meanwhile, Power of the Wild was played.
And damage consideration, but probably face, eh? Well, like I said, 15, you just like to push that.
Yeah.
Oh, okay. So you need taunt, right? You have to have taunt. It's just too many attacks. Tap for taunt.
Yeah. I mean, I guess you can play Knife Juggler, and you get a lot of juggles. Knife Juggler trading the Sea Giant to the Violet Teacher. Then you get a juggle from the Imp Gang Boss. You get two juggles from Dark Peddler, and whatever you get out of it. Oh, no. You can have enough. Yeah, you have enough mana. And then, I mean, it's risky to play Flame Imp, but...
So he has to kill one of them, otherwise he's dead. Feral Rage Hero Power is 5, 6 on board, total 11. Ooh, yeah. Archer and a Taunt. I don't even know which one you pick.
Yeah, you can't see it on. There's a Shield Bearer, an Elven Archer, and a Murloc Raider are the three choices.
So Archer lets you for sure kill the creature, but Shield Bearer is pretty nice when you're so low on health.
Yeah. Yeah, Shield Bearer. But if the Shield Bearer comes down and it doesn't pick off one of these two ones, it might have been a net benefit to go for the... Okay.
Oh, wow.
The invisible juggle is the deadliest.
So this Warlock board got huge all of a sudden. Need three more turns to Yogg. Both innervates are played, so there's no way to go faster. Oh, that lets you go faster.
And JJ wisely not playing this Flame Imp either.
Kind of like the Feral Rage for damage, so you can kill the Sea Giant this turn.
Okay.
And then you play the Mire Keeper for mana. Next turn you can taunt Hero Power and then Yogg.
But you kill
it. Definitely with a lot of options.
Face?
I don't know. There's a lot of options here.
All right. There's also just slamming Ancient of War, but that gets traded into way too easily, I feel. So going for the mana and two.
Got a face tank.
Yeah. To JJ, that can only mean one thing.
Yeah, when you
when
see
you're
them
ramping
pick up
from
mana,
7 to 8 mana.
Yeah, you know.
Yeah.
It's coming.
But of course, you can always hope it backfires, right? Just because
sure.
you know it's coming could even work to your advantage.
Yeah.
Which is a very unique card.
But this is 7.
Kind of want a Doomguard. Like Direwolf Doomguard, just put a huge amount of pressure on, sets you up for lethal next turn.
Yeah. So
then if they don't have a way to stop you, you can kill them before Yogg.
I think you trade in the, well, you Direwolf Alpha first,
yeah.
Evaluate the juggle, then trade in the Imp Gang boss, evaluate the juggle. Because you do want to clear the board. You have to for the risk of Savage Roar.
This is one of those times where you have like RNG and trading mechanics in play that it really takes a professional to know how to get the max value out of all these trades in order.
Yeah.
The way you do it.
It would take a computer to know the...
No! Get the 2/2 first with the imp. See how this happened?
Yep.
Yeah. Right.
Yeah. But
are you saying JJ is not a professional e-cop?
Oh, it could have been better.
Okay.
Oh.
Yeah.
That was unlucky.
That's kind of a punish. I mean, it's not too too consequential because it was only one damage missed at the end of the day.
He loses the peddler, too.
And he loses the peddler, oh yeah. So potentially 3 damage missed.
Actually a pretty big deal, especially with, like, essentially just the 10 HP sitting in front of the druid next turn. Any extra damage was huge.
All right. Well, Ancient of War going to block a lot of damage. He's going to live through this turn, I think, no matter what. I don't think there's a way to push through.
That's a lot of damage.
It's...
I don't know.
Famous last words, TJ. But,
no,
in this case,
that's like
no
the
way.
Most damage he could have drawn, right?
Yeah, but okay, so Direwolf Alpha is maximum 3. Voidwalker would be 4.
You get 2 juggles.
And Power Bomb would be 8. So the maximum possible damage would be 14 plus 5.
19.
Which.
He's at 21.
He's okay. At 21. So there's 0 possible ways.
The lower you get him, of course, the worse that Yogg's going to be.
That's true, yeah. So, and you.
So
if we go by
were we 2 damage short and then the peddler would have killed him?
If everything rolled maximum. Like if he got perfect...
Well, and the wolf would buff too then, right? So we'd even get an extra damage.
What about Crazed Alchemist?
So he'd have to Power Bombing Doomguard, yeah. Trade that in first to kill off the...
And then the wolf couldn't double buff anyways.
Okay.
Well, if you want Strifecrow to win, I think you better start praising Yogg right now.
What was that? That wolf's looking awfully lonely over there to the right. I guess he figured it doesn't matter. Yogg's runs there anyway, but he could have done a lot more. What's going?
Okay.
Ooh. Mind blast. Force of nature, okay. That doesn't matter.
Guess the Thistle Tea. Triple Fandral.
Mark of the Wild.
His own guy? Okay.
Natural.
Oh.
That's not good.
Yeah,
that's
not good.
That's one of the few spells that you don't want to get off of Yogg.
Yeah. All right, this Yogg is really underwhelming so far. There's a Hellfire.
Oh, my God.
He's going to be at 1.
Well, that was a pretty good Yogg, I think. The final spell
Okay. He really got saved by that Hellfire at the end. All right. Well, if you count up all of the damage that JJ missed by his missequencing and
yeah, he might have.
And by
losing
his dispositioning, even at the end there, Even if you look at last turn, he could have done a maximum damage if he had Power Roam the Doomguard and then traded all his minions in and got the Juggles to face. Yeah. He would have done an extra 3 damage, plus the 3 damage from the Dark Peddler getting in for 2, and the extra Juggle that he would have got from that one Juggle turn.
Yeah.
I think that was a 1 game for JJ.
Yeah.
I mean, there's a lot of RNG there, right? We say
sure,
that after
okay.
the fact, but yeah, I agree. Like, I think there were minor things there that could have gone better, right? And now it's going to come down to the final match, so this is very scary for both players. Whichever one loses, they're eliminated from the tournament, so.
Yeah. And that's not what you want to do. Okay, if you get eliminated from the second group stage, you can at least go away saying, okay, I accomplished something, you know?
I mean, I don't know. All these players are super strong, right? I'm not going to feel bad
You can put in your Twitter profile, top 16. Seed Story Cup, or your Twitch page, top 16 Seed Story Cup.
What do you think? Does this affect JJ mentally? I mean, he knows he probably could have played it better.
I mean, I was looking at his face even on the last turn, where he just kind of threw the Direwolf out there, threw the Power of Roaming out there. I think he could have done 3 extra damage on that turn.
He just wants to go drinking.
Sure, yeah.
JJ definitely likes to party.
Or he just thought, whatever, he's going to play Yogg next turn. I'll let Yogg decide it.
All right, this is a really cool choice. Savagery is actually something you can legitimately take with Feral Rage.
Yeah, yeah.
Essentially, it works like a shield slam for a druid, which is really rare that you can get tempo clear.
Yeah. That's true. Oh, my gosh.
On the other side, Mark of Nature, most of your creatures have high attack, and then it's giving you a taunt to defend. I mean, even Bite Solid, all of those choices are debatable.
Yeah. And it goes ahead and takes Savagery. But the thing is, Savagery has a very limited use. It's not like Shield Slam in the fact that you can just bank up your armor and then use it.
Yeah, you have to use it.
You have to use it on the turn where you Feral Rage.
But it's also good for the Violet Teacher because it's a 1-mana spell.
Yeah. And, I mean, against this deck, it's probably pretty sick because...
You don't want to face tank those creatures first and then...
And also, Earth Elemental is exactly 8 health, yep. Which is Feral Rage Savagery, even though it's 2 cards.
Since we don't see Savagery very much, I'll mention that Savagery can only hit a minion. It does damage equal to your hero's attack, so when you Feral Rage, you have 4 attack, it does 4, but you can't target face with it.
I think Feral or Savagery used to be like a Blade Flurry effect, didn't it?
Oh yeah, it used to cost it used to cost 2, and it used to hit all the minions.
For your attack.
Yeah.
Yeah, yeah.
Now that's what I call a beast druid.
Yeah. Oh, poor Savagery. What have you become?
Poor Blade Flurry.
Yeah, Blade Flurry's next, yeah.
Let's be real. Blade Flurry would be so overpowered right now if you could actually play that for 2 mana.
Yeah, I suppose.
Would it be, though? There's not that many buffs for weapons in Standard, so...
Everybody plays 3 HP creatures. Like Shaman and Zoo would just get removed each time.
Yeah. Like Tunnel Trog Feral Spirits.
Yeah.
Easy peasy.
You would have to play like South Sea Squid Face.
And the face damage.
South Sea Squid Face.
All right. I mean, if we get an Emperor Tharza in here, JJ's hand's looking pretty decently towards what he wants to accomplish.
Yeah.
The tokens are probably worse than C'Thun in this match. Now, obviously, I haven't played JJ Shaman much, but has really good AoE removal, so the things such as tokens are just going to die quickly to the destructions.
For some reason, I thought this was like the Earth Elemental Shaman, but this is just straight up Malago Shaman. I wasn't here for JJ's first matchup early on in the day.
Yeah, it's pretty cool that the first group had 2 different types of control shamans when almost always we see aggro shamans.
Now everybody's just going to get tired of control shaman. They're going to be like, where's the Doom Hammers?
That is a big turn for Strifecrow right there. Even though Super JJ probably will have no issues dealing with this board, thanks to like 4 AoE spells in his deck.
Yeah, plus Hex.
On the other side, you can just draw cards again next turn, so if the Shaman used their turn to remove, you get a free turn to draw.
Then at the end of the day, you're giving them time. That's what Malago Shaman wants.
What do you think about Hexing the Teacher there, and then you wait till next turn? You get Savage Roar.
Yeah, Savage Roar would be a lot of damage.
Yeah.
Besides, you can just roll high on the Lightning Storm and finish it up with a Lightning Bolt.
Easy.
Seems good.
I mean...
I kind of like the Mire Keeper over the Nourish, because you need something on board.
Really?
Doesn't necessarily need something on the board, but ramping here is... Oh, he's not... Okay. I was expecting him to, like, gain Mana Crystal so he gets so he can use them better with the Nourish.
Yeah. I guess he does realize that Super JJ is going to be overloaded pretty heavily next turn. So his... Oh, he does have Earth Elementals. That's what I thought.
Overload Shaman, I guess. I'm not much of an expert about these types of Shamans. It's really cool to see them play.
I mean, it's just a good control card, right? I mean, since he plays Lava Shock anyway in his deck, might as well play a big boy Taunter.
Hard removal's at a premium at the moment.
By the looks of it, he's going for a defensive strategy, right? He had these two Lightning Bolts with Malygos, which is working towards an OTK, and he's kind of given them up in exchange for having creature control.
Yep.
Might actually Raven Idol for a creature. Almost never Raven Idol for a creature since spells are class cards. They're more powerful each time, but no creature in hand.
Yeah. Definitely reasonable play to Raven Idol for a minion.
I do have a lot of respect for the people that Raven Idol for minion on turn one. Those guys have balls,
have you done
man.
That?
I've never done it before.
Well, you're more likely to get class one, I guess, so you get Darnassus Aspirant. Perfect
curve.
Yeah,
but like, I've had people that, like, at high legend will pick Raven Idol minion on their first turn. I'm like, wow, they're holding on to that. And then they, like, slam a Deathwing or something like that. They slam a Stampeding Kodo on, like, an Acolyte of Pain that I wasn't expecting.
Oh, Fandral value showing up.
Good thing you don't have that dilemma when you have Fandral.
Yeah. This is a huge turn. You get to Feral Rage for armor, too.
Yeah, that's true. And that's if you don't pick up an even better spell from the Raven Idol. Yeah. You can get Fandral into Raven Idol into Raven Idol.
Oh. Wow.
Into Raven Idol.
I will say that I don't think they've pitched the bug yet with Fandral where you can get the same choice twice off of Fandral. When you Raven Idol with Fandral, it can offer you the same spells.
Living Roots.
Nice.
I know that's just one spell. Pretty nice.
Savage Roar. No, Living Roots because you have her Savage Roar already.
But this is like, you know it's Control Shaman, right? You want to kill him with a burst.
That's true.
Yeah, at some point of the game, Shaman will not be able to deal with the board of the Druid. Like, there will be, consequentially, one turn where that just doesn't happen, that the Druid will have no board. So that, in that case, having the double Savage Roar ready might catch JJ off guard.
I like seeing our old friend, the Ancient Allure, in hand. It's been quite a while since he's made an appearance. Just been sitting on the sideline watching the other Druid cards.
Yeah, but come on, man. He's been through a lot.
He's seen enough battles.
Forced into retirement.
You can clear. Lightning Storm, Stormcrack's pretty good. I don't think you ever want to leave Fandral on board. You can totem first, see if you get spell power, and then you can Stormcrack with spell power.
Yeah.
So he'll be overloaded for three next turn, leaving him with six mana, which is still pretty friendly.
Having Sylvanas at three mana gives you a lot of flexibility.
Yeah.
Is there anything that you... I don't think there's anything that you have to hold on until Sylvanas for in this matchup.
Yogg-Saron. What do you laugh? That's the only counter to Yogg-Saron.
It is.
But there's so many ways that Yogg-Saron can just remove it without itself, without... It's stealing.
Yeah, but you don't take that risk, right? You have to kill it first.
And that's you have to expect the Yogg-Saron. You have to preemptively play it before Yogg-Saron
comes
out.
He leaves Fandral in play.
Uh-oh. Yeah, going by the model of how many... He can't have that many choose one spells, right?
Oh, man.
He's thinking, how many choose one spells do these druids run nowadays?
Oh, we have a lot, too. We have Savage Roar. We have that Savagery.
I can't play Living Roots, Savage Roar, and Feral Rage.
That's a complicated Durin, definitely. I'm curious to see what he does. I won't even attempt to make a call about what the best play is.
But Savage Roar can also be done with Savagery because Savage Roar also gives you attack.
That's like that tense moment where you can't afford a mistake here, right? This is that horrible turn that you just fear in a tournament where it's so complicated.
So if you Savage Roar, Living Roots, Savagery...
I guess he's playing for Yogg value. You want to try to kill, clear the board as much as you can this turn, play for Yogg value later. Oh, my God.
There you go. Oh, what?
He's going to do a full trade.
Okay.
Or face damage.
Well, I feel like that turn might have been able to be a little bit stronger, but that's still a really great way to get to that Earth Elemental. So,
well, he drew most cards that turn, right? He was focused on getting further through his deck.
Also,
it's also fine to just have the clean kill on the Earth Elemental right there, like Stripe did, and also having the clean kill on the board right now against the Sylvanas. Just not even giving Super JJ an opportunity to like have some potentially good trades where he steals something as well.
Yeah.
I don't know what you do with JJ's hand. How do you mount any pressure? You can heal yourself this turn and kill the Fandral, and you just wait, and you got to draw something else that helps you in this fight.
I mean, that's what the deck does, right? It waits a lot, and then eventually plays Maligos and wins. Hopefully.
Or your opponent concedes.
Does he win with Maligos?
Well, yeah, that's the question.
He played both Lightning Bolts. Okay, could go to full health.
Yep. Hey, he's played both Lightning Bolts. What other bursts does he have left?
There's the Frost Shock. Or Frost Shock.
Oh, yeah, Frost Shock.
Who knows? Maybe it's two.
Oh.
Yeah, he's playing Frost Shock in the deck. Maligos combo.
It's the mystery of the Seed Story Cup at the moment. Does Super JJ run two Frost Shocks? Only time will tell.
Place that 7 mana Iso Druid right
so
there.
Sad, yeah.
Could have played the fight.
I thought it was frozen. It was like, where's the second card?
I kind of like
poor
the
guy.
Power of the Wild, but you do know that, like, most of the Shaman's cards are board clears, right? He has 3 board clears remaining, so if you did like Roots and then Power of the Wild, you can Savage Roar next turn for some insane damage.
All right, everybody at home, cover most of Strifecrow's hand except for the Savage Roar and look at the board. It's almost like a time machine.
Oh my god, it's combo Druid again. In fact, this is kind of more combo-y, isn't it? With Fandral, you have real combos now.
Yeah, Violet Teacher.
Okay, I guess you hex the 5/5. You need a creature to stick to the board. Or you just play Maligos. When else are you going to play it, right? You had full health.
Yeah. Could also try and totem up first.
I guess
if you get a spell power totem, you don't need
to. So you just throw away your win condition like that?
Well, I mean, he played both Lightning Bolts. And then also, Shaman has this problem with Overload, right? That often you can't play a creature that expensive when you're overloaded.
Yeah, well, he just has to wait until he picks up Thorisson, I suppose.
Yep. That Yogg looks mighty tempting.
Yeah, you don't really sacrifice a lot, just 3 small minions.
Then you have a lot of spells to power it up still.
I think...
Is there never a scenario where, like, statistically, it's too many spells?
When you're at fatigue. Because Yogg draws cards, right?
Yeah.
That's the disadvantage. Otherwise, it's always good.
Whoa, man.
I have
old
faith.
Words.
I praise. Have to treat him well.
Feed him well.
Oh,
here we
okay.
go.
It's happening.
Didn't even try to get the Bloodlust out of it.
Yeah. Blood Warriors and a Hex. Polymorph.
Yep.
Yogg-Saron's true form. Oh,
that's pretty good.
I guess so. I mean, he's going to have a lot of time to be able to play those. Claw, Shadow Bolt, that's a clear.
Oh, man.
That's actually not...
Vaporize is super good.
Too bad.
Oh, there's plenty more to come.
Yeah. They're all useless. Oh, no, he's going to overdraw. Mire Keeper.
I think that Vaporize is going to be very annoying to deal with. You only have large creatures in this deck, right?
I think he only has 2 minions left, right? Or 3.
He needs the...
Earth Elemental Maligos and Emperor Thorsen.
Well, there's always
it.
The occasional 1-1 totem.
Yeah, the Fire Totem.
Oh, yeah, that's right.
Oh, no, he threw away one of the Earth Elementals. Only has 2 more now.
Wow, bummer.
That Emperor Thorsen seems mighty juicy here.
Yeah. You can even play your 2 worthless imps.
That's not nice. They have worth.
No, they're worthless imps.
Even Blizzard determined that.
I think Emperor Thor's hand's a must here with this hand size. But it's how much do you want to load onto the board? You want to try and bait out any AoE that's there? So yeah, I think I just like double worthless imp. And then hero power.
Well, you know it's not effigy since you played the imps. Always have to start that process of determining what secret it is.
Maybe the bluff. He's mind games.
Yeah. Sick bluff.
Card count. Druid has six. Shaman has 9, so Druid will fatigue first despite the gang up.
Yeah. I mean, he did draw, like,
a lot.
5 other cards from Yogg-Saron. He put 3 in his deck, but he took 5 out. There's another one.
That's actually a really hard creature to remove for the Shaman since you mostly deal with AoE damage.
Yeah, especially since, I mean, it's pretty cheap. You can play it here at the same time as, like, you could Earth Elemental, Azure Drake, Power of the Wild. So then you make 2 reasonable size threats.
Could probably justify the Frost Shock on the Earth Elemental.
So by this time now, I doubt JJ will even win with damage.
Yeah.
Because Druid also racks up so much armor. But however, when we take a look at the card count, like you said, the most reasonable plan might actually be fatiguing Strifecrow here for JJ, right?
Yeah, JJ has both his elemental destructions yet, so you could clear off a lot of large creatures.
Creatures.
Minions. Never gonna live that down.
I can imagine you running through the forest in Canada, playing with your creatures.
I feel like there should be a golden monkey in this shaman deck. There just seems like so many cards you can have left over at the end.
Yeah.
Ooh, there's the big man.
I always wondered why all control decks don't just play Elise. It's one card.
I mean, C'Thun kind of beats Elise right now.
Yeah, but you could play C'Thun and Elise.
You can.
I don't know, just like...
Some people do that.
Like Elise is a 3/5 body for 4 mana, which is like sort of average. I mean, 3/5s usually have an extra effect for 4 mana, like Fandral or Ascended Chill Master, but...
Problem is with Elise, it's only good against control, and the meta is heavily influenced by control decks right now.
All 3 old gods beat it. All 3 old gods. N'Zoth puts too much on the board. C'Thun clears the board. Yogg-Saron is questionable, but he's Yogg-Saron. So.
Yeah, but Elise can get all 3 of those.
That's
old gods.
True. I have gotten a C'Thun out of my Elise before, which is always nice.
Just saying.
I feel like we're in the death throes of Shaman right now. I don't see how he can attack.
Yeah.
Might have a Cairn left. He had Sylvanas in the deck. I don't know the whole deck, but Cairn would be something that could stick around a bit.
Yeah.
We don't know the whole deck, but we might get into the stage of the game where we see the whole deck.
Yep.
Which I'm sure whoever's waiting left in this group, which is Oskaka, is watching. So we can know every single card. Because he has to play whoever wins this for the group decider.
Yep.
It would only make sense. I saw Xalay downstairs taking notes, RDU, on their group.
Yeah, it's more work than people expect a lot of the time, where you want to be at the party, but as soon as you're not eliminated, you have to watch every match.
You have to play pretty diligently.
Well, that is a big pickup.
Yeah, we can stall the game a bit, I guess, right? Can Stormcrack trade Elemental Destruction for a full clear? He's already checked for Counterspell and Spellbender, so he knows his removal is safe.
But once he deals with this board, how does he deal with the next board that gets made? And the next board?
Well, there's not a lot of cards left, right? Scenarios, and then is there anything else Druid actually has?
Yeah, Oh, wait, maybe not. Both Violet Teachers have been played.
Oh, he has another Earth Elemental.
There's an Earth Elemental left.
Yogg-Saron giveth the win.
It's kind of funny. When that first happened, I was like, there's no way that these Earth Elementals are going to have any impact on this game. I'm not used to games going this long after Yogg-Saron's played.
Yeah.
We might actually see this Ancient of War being ignored here, hoping it dies to the Lightning Storm. Oh, or I guess he just wants to...
He sets Malygos Lightning Storm.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, Violet Teacher, nice.
Yeah, I thought I remember.
Well, that was the previous game, I guess.
Yeah, yeah, with both Violet Teachers were on the board at the same time.
So I mean, just take the safe trade. Then you have a bunch of options. You could play your 2/4 creatures, or you could play the Cenarius.
I think Cenarius can be used as sort of a maybe not, because you know your opponent still has AoE left.
He decides to play this as a Drake, even though he only has 2 cards in his deck.
That's a nice draw.
That's a very nice draw.
This prevents him from overinvesting the board. And AoE on 2 creatures is not valuable enough.
And he pushes damage. 2 damage to face from the swipe, 5, and 1 from the hero power would be 8 additional face damage. Plus, like you mentioned, yeah, it doesn't overextend. Makes a lot of sense.
I wonder what his last card is.
Earth Elemental.
Oh, yeah.
Right? Because he discarded one and he played one.
Yep. So that swipe was definitely the better draw there.
Yeah. And so Strifecoat's going to try and bait out the rest of the AoE here. Because he knows what these last cards are. And Ancestral Knowledge can probably just be used. He's looking at the remaining cards in his deck, and there's still 6. So
he should have a Overload removal. Actually, a pretty high chance to draw Overload removal. Yeah. I don't think he's played any.
But what's the rest? You can tell Super JJ is really trying to think.
Yeah.
Like, what's there?
Looks like he was trying to get the spell damage totem.
No, he was channeling his power. He wasn't thinking. He was just trying his hardest to get... Spell Power Totem. I don't know, this is going to be tough.
I dig that. Next turn you have Malygos Lightning Storm.
Oh, Halazeal.
There you go.
So that's... could be a game changer, Halazeal plus Lightning Storm. And goes ahead and Storm corrects this, so 6 damage on the board, plus Savage Roar would be 14.
JJ definitely worried about the Savage Roar. Didn't want to wait for the Lightning Storm to clear the Ancient of War.
I really
want
to see that Vaporize take effect. I think you're probably expecting Ice Block or something at this point, right?
Yeah.
There's no way you don't attack when you get the chance to.
You've gone through everything else, right? It could be Ice Barrier, Ice Block.
Yep.
Can't be Spellbender, can't be Counterspell.
Nope.
Can't be Mirror Entity, can't be Effigy.
So you have to attack to find out. And I mean, you go for it, right?
Yeah.
Malygos getting vaporized would be the ultimate end.
Yeah. But maybe if Strifecoat plays Cenarius here, he leaves the 1-1 up. If he kills it, he gives way to Super JJ that it's... I don't know, maybe not. Yeah, but you push face damage here regardless.
Malygos Lightning Storm is 7 to 8 damage, so potentially a full... Oh, he can't afford it. He's overloaded one.
He can Halazeal plus Lightning Storm.
Yeah, JJ finds the Halazeal. I'm pretty sure he's happy about that.
If he wasn't overloaded, he got a guaranteed clear because he could trade the 1-1 on the 5-8 if it failed. But that one overload.
Yep.
Does he get spell damage? No.
Spell damage is a huge deal because it would have healed him more and guaranteed to kill him with 3-3s, so he needs to kill these. Oh, no.
Both.
And that's it. Savage Roar ends it.
Well.
Wow. And that means Strifecrow is going to make the comeback and win 3-2 over Super JJ after going down.
Praise Yogg.
Praise Yogg.
Praise Yogg indeed.
That was a good series.
Oh, yeah. No. Team Horus won 200 points.
Team Horus, yeah.
Yeah.
Oh, man.
Yeah.
Well, that feels bad for me.
All right, we got to make room for the crow here. Scooch on down. Oh, we can. No, he's got a microphone.
I don't think it's working, by the way.
It is.
It is. We can hear you, yeah. So how do you feel, man?
I feel good. That was a pretty intense series. Very intense.
Yeah, so what was your favorite part about the series?
My favorite part, I think, was that Yogg. it was like, for that Yogg, it wasn't looking that good, you know? Then I got the three Earth Elementals, so I was like, all right, that's looking pretty good.
I think
it just got a little bit better and better.
The one before against the zoo where the last spell was Hellfire, you were dead until you got that last spell.
But I mean, I was so high percentage of clear with Yogg. I mean, that was like 10 spells and a tiny board. I think I would clear that 90% of the time with Yogg.
Yeah, he had made a couple of minor things that we think
like
might
his
have
trades with the knife juggler and stuff
might have given him an edge in that druid versus zoo where he actually could have taken you, but it was going to be close.
I didn't really hear what he said.
There was a couple of plays at the end of the druid versus warlock game where he did the juggles in the wrong order and he saved a power overwhelming in his hand. That might have made the difference.
Maybe that was epic. I was like that Yogg was like, okay, it's not going that good. And then I got the Hellfire.
Yeah.
Ooh,
that was the last one.
I was so relieved.
So you were, you probably scouted JJ's decks going into this match, right?
Yeah.
So what was your strategy going into this match? Like, what was your game plan?
Ban Warrior, try to win.
Wow, sick strategy, man.
Yeah.
Tilt him with top decks.
Yeah.
You made sure to use the top deck living roots?
I make sure I use the top deck one. I know Super JJ likes to tilt sometimes, so yeah. I use the top deck ones.
Now that we've seen sort of like, you know, almost a full group playthrough, I'm going to ask for your bold prediction. What deck is going to be sort of like the MVP deck of the entire tournament?
Of this tournament?
Of the whole tournament. Like, what deck is going to carry somebody to the finals and win the finals?
I don't think it's Warrior because everyone that is not banning Warriors is basically everyone's banning Warrior except if you're prepared for it. So I don't think Warriors will be that great.
Okay.
I think it's going to be either Yogg Druid or that Shaman.
Okay.
Yep.
Wait, what Shaman did you say?
Like a Earth Elemental Faceless one.
Okay. Not Aggro Shaman?
Not Aggro Shaman.
How scary of a world is it when there's like five archetypes of Shaman that are powerful?
Yeah, I mean, there's like five shamans, five warriors, and they're all like tier one pretty much. So
yeah.
It's pretty diverse right now.
Yeah. So you have to go up against
Oskaka
next. How you feeling?
I actually feel good about that one. I think Freezing Mage is a terrible deck right now.
Whoa.
So where
is he?
I'm just going to leave up that deck and then try to farm that, you know.
That's like mind games. Are you like going to tell him that you're leaving it up and then right at the last second you're just going to ban it?
Yeah. Pretty much.
Good strategy. Well, you guys have any more questions?
Nah, good games. That was really
congratulations
good.
And good luck against Oskaka.
Yeah, should be good. That'll be the decider match. Of course, Frodan won 6-0 out of the group. Super JJ has been eliminated, unfortunately. Had a good run last time too, but his run has stopped now. But we got a lot more games to come. We're gonna have another match coming up right next. So don't go anywhere, guys. More C3 Cup right after this.